having studied the three modes of heat transfer, let's shift our focus to one of those modes, conduction. The ability to conduct heat is known as thermal conductivity. Let's understand what exactly is thermal conductivity. What I've drawn over here is a cylindrical rod, or basically a cylindrical object. One end of this rod is kept at temperature T1 and the other end at T2. I could have an arrangement like that. A very basic idea is, let's say T1 is kept at a stove and that stove is maintaining this temperature T1. And this end is just kept out to the atmosphere. And as atmosphere's temperature won't change, so this temperature won't change. So this is one way to achieve constant temperatures at two ends. But naturally, if this is my stove, my T1 would be essentially greater than T2. And this is being maintained by both the ends. And as I have taken a cylindrical object, the area of cross-section would be same throughout. Now, what will happen is, initially, this end would have very high temperature, right? And this end would have very low temperature. Or rather, even if you remove the very from this statement, this end would have a high temperature, this would have a low temperature. So naturally, heat would like to flow from here to here. And as I'm studying just conduction, my analysis would be just limited to conduction. So heated up molecules here could transfer the energy or randomness to this side, and then this side would transfer the randomness to this side. So heat flow would take place, right? Now, with time, what will happen is there would be an increase in temperature across the cross-section. And there would be a state when the temperature stops increasing, which means each of the cross section has their own constant temperature, by which I mean that this has T1, this has something lesser than T1, this would have something lesser than T1, some amount more or less, it would continuously decrease to T2, right? But after that state has been achieved, there would be no change in temperature in any of the cross section. Now that is your steady state. So when we achieve that steady state, heat entering a cross section must be equal to heat exiting a cross section per unit time. So this arrow over here represents delta Q upon delta T in, that should be equal to delta Q upon delta T in, which means if you take any cross section, the same amount of heat would keep on flowing. And the reason for this is my assumption that this object is cylindrical, so area of cross section must be same, and steady state has been achieved. So when steady state has been achieved and area of cross section across that object is same, then heat flow, or the rate of heat flow, is equal to K times A times temperature difference upon X. And let's understand this a bit more. Here, A is the area of cross section. T1 minus T2 is the temperature difference. X is the separation between the two ends. And K is the thermal conductivity. This thing over here, this is what we are after. Thermal conductivity. And this thermal conductivity is actually the ability of a material to conduct heat. Right? And this is what we are interested in this chapter as of now. So thermal conductivity of a material gives me an idea of how much heat energy can flow. So if K is higher, more heat energy would flow per unit time, right? And this is in somewhat relation to the electrical conductivity. All good conductors of heat are also good conductors of electricity. There's no such rigorous mathematical or physics explanation to this. But yes, this kind of makes sense, because if you have more conduction through a medium, it means that the molecules inside are mobile, which means even for electricity, those molecules would be mobile. So this is kind of a vague explanation, a vague reasoning, kind of an analogy-based reasoning, no scientific basis to it. So just take it from me that all good conductors of electricity are usually good conductors of heat too. Now, I've taken two assumptions over here. First one, steady state, and the next one, uniform cross-section. But let's say uniform cross-section has not been achieved, and even steady state has not been achieved, which means it could be a very random order, like something like this. This is my object. If this is my object, this cross-section and this cross-section are very different from each other, right? So in this situation, I cannot apply this formula. But what I can still apply is, let's take a very small amount of that object. So in that small object, I'll have a dx thickness, right? And in this dx thickness, there will be change in temperature. If heat is flowing in this direction, obviously temperature has to decrease from here to here. So your dt would be negative. Why negative? Because if heat is flowing from here to here, your dq upon dt, right? So naturally temperature of this end would be greater, so dt would be negative. So what I can convert this equation to is, small q represents small heat. I can also write a capital Q, doesn't make much of a difference, but yeah, just if I'm using small, so everything should be in small to make it more coherent with our idea. Now, same thing again. K, A, because A is not changing, I'm taking A of this cross-section. K, A, dt upon dx with a negative sign. Why negative sign? Because my dt is negative and my heat current or the rate of heat flow has to be positive because I have assumed it to be in this direction. That is true. See, just now I mentioned a new thing, heat current, which is nothing new, just the rate of heat flow. Because river current is the rate of flow of water, similarly heat current is the rate of flow of heat. So here, this definition is more exact because this is valid for all the cases, for all, if steady state has been achieved or not, if cross-section area is uniform throughout or not. And if I use this as my base, I can also get this, right? Because if you just think of dt, it's this temperature difference, dx, length of the conductor, right? Or the material. So essentially these two are the same formula. This is more general and this is more specific. The specific one is for the steady state and for uniform cross-section area, right? And over here, I can have one more analogy. How? Heat current. This is heat current. So in place of dq upon dt, I could also write iq, where iq is your heat current. Now, it's this heat current can be studied similar to your current electricity. How? dq upon dt is your iq. So, iq is equal to minus kA dt upon dx. Just manipulate this further. What you will get is minus dt upon dx by kA. Now, this thing over here is your temperature difference. This thing over here is your temperature difference. And this thing over here is your thermal resistance. How, if you remember the chapter on electricity, Ohm's law says that I is equal to potential difference upon the electrical resistance, right? So similarly here, what I have done is heat current is equal to temperature difference in place of potential difference, and this denominator can be thought of as your thermal resistance. So thermal resistance can be now thought of as this. IQ is equal to temperature difference, which is, let's say, delta T divided by R thermal. Now here, R thermal for a uniform object or uniform cross-section object would be simply equal to X by Ka. Why? The reason being, if you take this K down and A also down, you just get X by Ka. So this is your thermal resistance, right? So right now what you've understood is all about thermal conductivity. Higher the thermal conductivity K, more the ability of a material to conduct heat or transfer heat. And I can relate the heat flow with current electricity. Rate of heat flow or heat current IQ is equal to delta T upon R thermal, where delta T is change in temperature, or higher temperature minus lower temperature. And R thermal is your thermal resistance, which can be written as length of conductor upon Ka, where K is thermal conductivity and A is area of cross-section. And in other words, if you are taking a very small cross-section or a very small element, this element, then this is replaced by this formula, in which minus dt is the temperature difference, because dt is negative obviously, and dx upon k is your thermal resistance.